My name is Sean McDonagh. I was born in Ireland in the 1940s. I was ordained 47 years ago at this time. This is an extraordinary dog, a Laudato Si. If you'd asked me 5 years ago, would I expect to see it in my lifetime? I would have said no.
So the encyclical deals with environmental issues very extensively in chapter one. It also deals with economic interests. He calls these the cry of the earth and the cry of the poor. But it is really an evangelical document. It's something saying to us, how should we live as Christians in the 21st century? So we look at some of the issues here. In the encyclical, he deals with poverty, why people are poor, why a huge segment of the population of the world, over a billion people are poor, and how we can change that as part of our Christian understanding. It also deals with issues that are major in the world today, the chemicalization of the planet, particularly in areas of agriculture, climate change. As Anne said, we have COP22, the Conference of the Parties, to the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. They're meeting in Marrakesh, in Morocco, this week, to build on what they did last year in Paris by making these commitments to reduce greenhouse gases. It's also about pollution of fresh water and the oceans, and as you live on the edge of the largest ocean in the world, an extraordinarily polluted ocean, there's 5 trillion pieces of plastic in the Pacific Ocean. So it deals with the extractive industries and the impact they're having on the planet, and whether they're properly remediated after they have been used. It also deals with waste and a throwaway society, plastic being a very good example of that. And so, also on the sustainable development into the future. So as I say, it starts that canticle, the prayer of St. Francis, an extraordinary man in the Middle Ages. In which he gives thanks to God for the beauty of creation, and he gives thanks to God also for his relationship with other human beings. And he used the word family. He talks about brother fire, sister moon, mother earth. So in that sense he was very unusual for his time, very, very sensitive to the reality of the planet. I think it's one of the most important documents, the first papal encyclical on work, called Rerum Novarum. It was issued in 1891 by Pope Leo XIII. So, in this one, of course, was about the condition of workers and the ideology of liberal capitalism. This one is about the planet, and it's about the condition of our common home. That's the subtitle of the encyclical, Domus, house. So it's a common home not just for humans, it's a common home for all creation. And now we're called to care for that as centre. So he gets right into the, very quickly, number four, due to the ill-considered exploitation of nature, humanity runs the risk of destroying it and becoming a victim of this degradation. So he will get very quickly to the heart of the ecological issue, its magnitude right across the world in very different life systems, ecosystems, and the urgency with which it must be faced. And then he says, look, when you look around the world, it's more and more beginning to look like an immense pile of filth. Now, when people ask who wrote the document, I don't think anyone but Francis could have written that. Certainly academics wouldn't have written it, or some of his advisors wouldn't, but that's what he's seeing around him. And then he comes up with a very interesting reality, that Christians realize that their responsibility within creation and their duty towards nature and the Creator are an essential. Now that's new teaching. All of us growing up learning catechism in schools, learning at home from our parents, learning maybe in seminaries, very seldom did we ever think that our relationship with nature is an essential part of our faith. Rerum Novarum on new things was about the condition of workers in factories in 19th century Europe and North America, and how they had little rights, and how people saw that the market dictated everything. The second one is the threat of nuclear war when Pope John XXIII, beginning of the 1960s, with great fear about the war, great fear about the use of atomic or nuclear weapons. He wrote a document called Terrey and Terrace, and then the development of peoples at the end of colonialism in the early 1960s, late 1960s. How do we really judge proper development? Is it just increasing our GDP and getting a minority of people rich in a society, or is it by meeting the people's needs, food, clothing, shelter, healthcare, education, etc.? So, but this one is not just for the poor, it's not just for workers, it's a wider perspective, it's for all of creation as well. And that's why it is so important, and that's why other churches and other Christian faith groups, other Christian churches, have taken to it. So, he of course is building on previous teaching. The Catholic Church didn't have a lot of teaching on ecology, but the last three popes, Pope Paul VI, Pope John Paul II, and Pope Benedict, had some material, and he includes this in his encyclical. And for example, Pope John Paul II is the one who came up in 2001 with this idea of an ecological conversion. Now, conversion means you're going in the wrong direction, and something has happened, someone has spoken to you.
Laudato Si does two things. It focuses on the magnitude of the ecological destruction and the urgency with which it must be faced. That's it. There's no one saying, well, it's bad, but we can put it off until we've finished with until unemployment is down to 2%, until housing, you can't. We have learned that in the last 100 years. As I say, this is an extraordinary document for the Catholic Church. The World Council of Churches had worked hugely in the 1970s and 80s. I worked with them myself in the 80s and 90s. The Catholic Church hadn't. In actual fact, the Compendium of Social Teaching for the Church was published only in 2004 and has no sense of the ecological issue at all. For example, chapter 10 is on the environment. It is 15 pages. Now that's for 3.8 billion years of God's life creativity on the planet. The section on work, chapter 6, is 26 pages. And worse still, the climate change, a half a paragraph. You'd read this through without actually saying, well, that's climate change looked after. Destruction of biodiversity, we are extinguishing 100,000 species a year, half a paragraph. And biotechnology, now this really blows my mind, like biotechnology. This is the corporations of the world, Syngenta. 9 paragraphs, imagine 9 paragraphs. So that's where we've come from. The other thing that this Pope has done, which no Pope in recent times has done, is he actually coached bishops. He trusts bishops. There are 17 bishops' conferences published in this particular document. As I say, normally, when you're writing in 64 before, you quoted the scriptures, you quoted the fathers of the church. You didn't quote the mothers of the church. We haven't got around to that yet. Maybe, I think we should. You quote the schoolmen, maybe Aquinas, maybe Bonaventure. You quote modern popes, and you quote yourself. This man quotes all over the place, telling us that the church is local. And particularly environments are local. There was a guy here when I was in Washington, he was your representative, Tip O'Neill. Tip used to say, all politics is local. And he had a good reason for saying that, because Mr. Reagan was president. It was a bit after that he was president. The reality is, all politics might be local. All environments are local. There is no other environment like this anywhere on the planet. So, then he goes even way beyond that. Who is the central feature he personally introduces in the beginning of this encyclical? It's the Patriarch Bartholomew of the Greek Church. He's the Patriarch of Constantinople. Did wonderful work since he was elected in 1991, particularly on water. He started in 1994 bringing a ship onto the Black Sea with scientists, with politicians, economists, Christians, theologians. Why have we destroyed this? And of course, we destroyed it because of the policies of the USSR, their agricultural policies for 55 years before that. most of it was dead, as the area south of the Mississippi and the Caribbean is dead in this country. Question: why do we do it? Why were we not? Why were we aware, not aware when it was happening? And what are we going to do about it now? He has gone through all, many of the bodies of the world, water bodies, including the Mississippi, over the years. So he's wonderfully sensitive to this whole area. And so the moral responsibility comes straight from him, and he talks about it, for human beings to destroy the biological diversity of God's creation. For human beings to degrade the integrity of the earth by causing changes in its climate, by stripping the earth of its natural forest, or destroying its wetlands. Just about everything, yeah. And then he includes, for human beings to contaminate the earth's water, its land, its air, its life. So that's the patriarch saying, these are things. Now what's he going to say next? Maybe you shouldn't do that, or please don't do it, or he doesn't. He says something extraordinarily profound. These are sins. Now, the problem here is, again, we have to put our foot down on the brake. None of us here believe that. It's not part of loving God and loving your neighbor. But he's saying these are sins. And Francis, in the next line, repeats that these are sins. So we have a job as Christians. And it's not just Catholics. I mean, you're Episcopal Church is dealing with this in my own country. The Anglican Church is actually doing more, in many ways more with Laudato Si than the Catholic Churches. We have to develop in our moral imagination that these are sins, that these areas of our relationship with God, our relationship with other human beings, and our relationship with the earth are intertwined, as we will see in number 67. Now that's going to take a really strong catechesis to change the way we actually. Now, younger people are more sensitive to this because in their schooling, in their biology classes, in the way they look at the natural world, they're more open to it. But that's the first thing we have to. So, he also has taken on board this September 1 as the day when everyone prays for creation. I would hope we would be looking in the Catholic Church, in many churches around the world, including the Catholic Church in the Philippines. They have introduced this notion of season of creation. It's September, whether it's four Sundays or five Sundays. And you would need, for example, one Sunday with the oceans, another Sunday with water, another Sunday with soils, whatever it is. All your texts, your sermons, your prayers of it are all about that. And I think that's the kind of thing we need, and maybe we should be talking to our Archbishop here, and other bishops to bring in this whole notion of the seasons of creation as part of a catechesis. So he talks about every Christian tradition has something to offer for overcoming the ecological crisis, which is really facing our planet today. So here we have a new spirituality and new ethics. The new spirituality, as we will see in a moment, is this is the first document ever to talk about biodiversity. I mean, when you think of it, it's mind-boggling for a church that claims to be pro-life, that we have nothing to say about the 10 million other species on which we depend and are as close to us. Orangutans, we share 98.4 common DNA with them, so it's not as if they're living on another planet. And what they're basically saying is they have intrinsic value. They're at the end of their evolutionary journey as we are on ours as Homo sapiens. They are calling to us for a claim. The birds, the insects, and the wonder of how they actually create the world on which we live, and the trees. So one of the things of becoming part of trying to understand this will be creating the context where a new spirituality will take seriously our real understanding and our appreciation of all of God's creations. Not just from the head of learning botany, or biology, but from the experience of being part of creation. So, for 2,000 years, we have focused on human relations with God and with other human beings. Christians knew it was wrong to worship false gods. We have to read them the Hebrew scripture, to kill, to steal, commit adultery, you name it, to lie. But the majority of Christians did not think it was wrong to devastate the forests or drain the marshes. That's what you do with marshes, you drain them. We call them swamps. What do you do with swamps? Clean them out. They don't smell very well for a start. You don't like them. and they're very serious ecosystems on our planet today. Let's be honest, you know, those who ploughed up the prairies of North America in the 19th century, who cut down the forests in Ireland in the 7th to the 12th century, who mined for gold by using mercury or cyanide, who in my years in the Philippines cut down the tropical rain, they did not think these were morally wrong actions. They may have thought aspects were morally wrong. They weren't paying the workers, for example, in the Philippines a decent wage. But just taking down the forest, now we actually know these are. But the point I want to make, if we want this, we're asking for a profound, long-lasting influence on Catholic social teaching. We need a systematic, extensive moral catechesis aimed at bringing about the serious changes which are envisaged in this particular topic. So if we don't even see the serious changes, we won't see the necessity of this extraordinary change. So he talks about St. Francis and why he, as a Jesuit, interesting, he found him an attractive and compelling character. As a guide and inspiration for him, Bishop of Rome, which is 3 years ago, this next week, isn't it? The 13th of March. And I think it's four extraordinary reasons. His concern for the poor, and that was central to St. Francis' way of living. His concern for creation. Now, he didn't understand evolution. He thought every creature was created by God. But he had this extraordinary, not understood at that time, way of looking at nature. His commitment to society and to challenging what the brothers brought to the church at the time. But finally, this is the way of contemplation. This is the way of mysticism into the future, of being aware of every creature God has created for us has something specific to tell us about the reality of the divine. And that's included in this encyclical with a beautiful quotation from St. Thomas of Aquin. So then we say, well, why hasn't this all happened? And because the way we have presented the faith, particularly the second millennium, had an anti-body and an anti-creature, and particularly anti-women's body. I just go and read Augustine on that, but particularly go and read Jerome. And Jerome was actually bankrolled in Palestine as he was translating the text, by a group of women, some of them in Rome, some of them had lost their husbands. They should have been much more critical of what he was at. So we might like to think that St. Francis, his wonderful fraternal relationship with creation continued and blossomed in the centuries after his death. Sorry, it didn't. There's no historical evidence. It didn't happen. Francis' vision was lost, even among Franciscans. Or if it wasn't, please show me where. In the 15th century, Pietas Moderna was centered on a mysticism of our understanding of God's presence in other creatures. It wasn't. And there were very clear reasons for this. The dualism that we inherited from the Greek world, and particularly was put in place during the extraordinary, powerful focus and force that Augustine in the 5th century had on all the Christian churches. I mean, Augustine is by far the most powerful theologian since St. Paul. And the dualism was part of that. It was part of the Hellenistic world. So you had spirit and matter. And spirit was closer to the divine. And actually matter didn't matter. One of our own poets in Ireland, he wrote a wonderful poem in the 19th, things fall apart. That's what happens to matter. Matter falls apart. So it doesn't have anything of the divinity. Your own theologian here, Elizabeth Johnson, has written a beautiful book on this, God's Charity is Broad Enough for the Bears. I heard her last year in Maynooth in Ireland talking about this. We also had this wonder of, yes, when we talked, for example, today's reading of chapter 15 of Luke's Gospel, the gratuitous love of the Father. I mean, the first thing you have to remember about today's reading is this. Everyone who heard it was shocked. Absolutely shocked. No man ever spoke like that. Men didn't do that. In actual fact, the father had the right to have his son killed. He wanted his inheritance before he died. So that's what everyone believed. Every person there, male and female, who heard that this is not how fathers act. So We wanted to retain that and focus on the supernatural, and rightly so. But in the same time, we lost God's presence on the merely natural. And we've never seen it until very recently as central to our understanding of creation. So primarily what happened was creation no longer was seen as a gift. It was just seen as the background on which humans worked out their lives on this stage. Now the most extraordinary statement of Christianity and every religion that believes in God is actually life. I have life. The extraordinary miracle of life. And everything around me has life. And if I can't start with awe and reverence by what the sciences are telling us about how life emerged, but also gratitude for this extraordinary gift, I haven't even begun to think of God's presence in creation. So that's the first thing that has to change. The natural world is not a stage. The natural world is the reality which all of us are acting on today and changing. The second thing was an extraordinary traumatic event, which has got very little attention in the second millennium, but was the single most powerful and destructive reality that happened in Europe in the second millennium. It was the Black Death. From 1346 until 1553. The last place where there are records is the town of Kilkenny. It was the city of Kilkenny. It's about 45 miles south of London, or south of Dublin, where something like 4,000 people died. In Dublin itself, something like 16,000 people. It was a very small country. Right up from Drogheda, the whole Franciscan Friary died. That's what happened with the Black Death. Between 75 and 200 million people, and closer to 200, were lost in 5 years. We have from, for example, in places like Florence, in a period of 4 months, 70% of the population wiped out. It was extraordinary. It was so quick. You were well today, within a week you were dead, and with awful kinds of pain and suffering. So vast amounts of people were affected. How do you deal with it? That was the religious question. And this is what happened. It brought about these extraordinary changes that had a profound effect on European history. During the Black Death, the clergy were often very good. That's why so many of the good ones died. But after the Black Death, as what happened in the Irish famine, when you start looking at the statements of bishops in the 1850s, things change. They begin to say, why did God do this? We always have to have an answer for that. And fundamentally, God did it. He was punishing this generation. And then some bright people began to say, well, is this generation worse than the previous generation? Well, maybe, but maybe not. So why was he punishing us? And the other side of it, if you want to deal with it, it's a spiritual prayer, asceticism, mortification, and withdrawal from engagement in the world. That was the effect of the Black Death. And it lasted right until Vatican II. So creation had no value. This wonder that the primary revelation of God to us and all creatures for 4.8 billion years had nothing to say to us, which is just amazing. And of course, it worked out into the Reformation itself, where human degradation became so central, and the merits of Christ in bringing about redemption was so overwhelming that the natural world was completely lost. We kept saying that we were interested in nature, against the Lutheran reality of the 16th century. We had it in the Council of Trent. But we also took it on board. I was ordained 47 years ago this Easter Sunday. We still had a Mass in Latin. And this is what we prayed after communion. Oremus, let us pray. Domine, docius nos terrena dispicere et amarige. Teach us to despise the things of earth, terrena, the earthly things, et amara, and to love the things of heaven. Well, that gives you clearly what we taught. If we're to despise the things of heaven or things of earth, they have no value for us. And that's exactly. And that was the famous from the fathers, the Lex Orandi, the way we pray is the way we live and believe and what we do. That has to change dramatically. But even in the last translation, we were told to judge wisely the things of earth. and to love the things of heaven. Now, one of the things we've got to get straight into our minds, we are earthlings. We are not, this is our home. Our true home is on earth. Our belief in what happened to the life of Jesus, his passion, death, and resurrection, that's the promise of the future. We don't know the physics of it. We know Jesus went through walls. We don't know the chemistry of it. We know it as God's promise and we believe it. But we are earthlings. And you talk to the man, was it Kelly, who was one year up in space, there recently came down to Earth. He talks about he gained 2 inches in the sky. He talks about its impact on his bones. So we're earthlings, and we need. And again, we had the Jansenism. Again, it was condemned, but it worked its way into Irish Christianity. Four of the first teachers in the news in 1795 were Jansenists from the Sorbonne in France. And so we brought that with us, human depravity, original sin, confession, all of those. Did we bring, what about the wonder of, for example, the barn, where you look at the lower Carboniferous, where in the May morning you walk out and you see the spring gentians, and they're out there for 4 and 5 miles right out into the sea, and you're enthralled by God's beauty. Sure, you know, there are dangers and difficulties in this, but this is the wonder of God's creation as well. Like in the Rosary, with mourning and weeping in this valley of tears. Well, there's more to the world than just mourning and weeping. There's the absolute beauty of the world, of the birds of the air. Now we know, unfortunately, there are 9,000 species of birds, but 3,000 of them are on the red list at the moment, facing extinction. So that was the kind of spirituality that was in religious houses right up the Vatican II. Spirituality of priority to salvation of one's souls, one's future life in heaven, and very little involvement in the affairs of the world. To such an extent that Pope John Paul II, the same dozen, said in matter of just laity must not suppose they would be acting prudently to lessen their Christian commitment to this passing world. So he was aware we were holding back from the world. And he goes on and says, on the contrary, we insist they must intensify it, increase it continually. Let no one suppose that a life of activity in the world is incompatible with spiritual perfection. So that's the kind of world he challenges us to come out of. Now, not everyone. There were some things. And one that Pope Francis quotes, actually, in Laudato Si, is St. John of the Cross, where he begins to use the metaphors of creation. The mountains have heights. They are plentiful, vast and beautiful, graceful, bright and fragrant. These mountains are what my beloved was to me. But the reality is, so he's in a sense one of the only ones, but all of these priests were all reading the Psalms every day. Now, one third of the Psalms are about the beauty of God's creation. So how they were reading in Latin, Psalm 104, for example, about the beauty of creation, and not bringing that into their spirituality of the 17th, 18th, 19th century. That's the challenge we have to face. So, these four voices were exceptions. But today we have to have something quite different. We cannot have a jaundiced approach to the natural world. And Pope Francis acknowledges this. It's a mistake, understanding our principle, that at times has led us to justify mistreating nature, to exercise tyranny over creation, he uses that word, to engage in war, injustice, and acts of violence. So how could Catholic cultures, like Spain, for example, have bullfighting? What does it say about our understanding of bulls? It just is totally inimical. So, he comes to creation, the book of creation, particularly chapter 1. So, he talks about, now, the beginning, chapter 1 of creation is extraordinary, because it tells us that the world was created, the universe was created by a loving and personal God. Now, many, many cultures in the Middle East at the time did not believe that. Many believed that there were equally powerful cultures or spirits. There was a spirit of good and an equally powerful spirit of evil. The Jews couldn't believe that because their experience of God was quite different. So that's why they wrote, right, when they took the Gilgamesh epic, but they said it was good. Genesis chapter 1, 10, 13, 18, 21, 26. you've got to get it, it's good. And then when it came in 31 to talk about the creation of humans, it's very good. But then we go on to say, let us make in likeness of ourselves, and let them be masters of the sea, the birds of the air, the cattle, be fruitful, multiply, and fill the earth and conquer. So this is where we begin to get into a bit of trouble. How do we understand this conquer? Fill the earth and conquer, because it has had a profound impact on the way Jews and Christians have viewed the natural world. This is what we do. We don't just kill one or two. We just go out and slaughter and slaughter. And don't think it's immoral, because we have a right to subdue the earth. Well, Francis is aware that the Genesis account grants man dominion over the earth, has encouraged the unbridled exploitation of nature by painting him as domineering and destructive by nature. And now he does something that popes don't always do. He says this is an incorrect understanding of Genesis chapter 1, verse 28. Now, of course, if he goes back and reads Progressio Papalorum, that's the way it was understood in Progressio Papalorum. He goes on then to connect it with the second account of creation, which is very different. The first one is cosmological. You can see them going into the temple and singing and praising this. The second was the potter from the earth. So it was the tiller to keep, Genesis chapter 2, verse 15. Keeping, the Hebrew the word means caring, protecting, and overseeing. So for Pope Francis, the text calls humans to be thoughtful and careful in the way we're related to creation. But he does admit that it is true that we Christians have at times incorrectly interpreted the scripture. Nowadays, we must forcibly reject the notion of our being created in God's image, gives us dominion over the earth, which justifies absolute dominance over other creatures, what we did to the oceans. World War II ended on land in 1945. We have been fighting it in the oceans. Just look at what we're doing there with ships, taking literally tens of tons of fish out of, just every day, out of the oceans. The dominion given in Genesis is in fact to human to imitate God's loving kindness and faithfulness and to act as his leader, a viceroy, in relationship to a non-human component. Now, we haven't taken that seriously.
So in actual fact, for a parish like this, where you have pastoral care for each other and pastoral care within the context of the diocese and the parish, now you're going to be talking about pastoral care for the world around us as also part of that vocation as we understand it today. He also uses a wonderful text of the Sabbath, which comes there. We often think the Genesis account should have ended with the creation of humans, because if you're looking at more complex organisms, it should have ended with Genesis chapter 1, verse 33, but it doesn't. It ends actually with Genesis chapter 2, verse 4a, because the end is actually the creation of the Sabbath. And it's a huge reality for the people of Israel, because every week they can come, tell their story, and carry on their tradition. And it's exactly what we've been doing as Christians. We tell our story. Now we've got to change the story a bit to be in line with this, and we need an institution to carry on this story and share it with the future. So, in the Sabbath, you have processes of jubilee, which will make sure that we have an equitable society. If you don't have some processes to redistribute wealth, then wealth will go to the top, and a lot of people will be poor. So that's the function of a society, to share ideas of how we can create a society where there is a disparity between rich and poor. But we have to remember that as Europeans, we did give centuries of interpretation to the old way of looking at it. And I'll just go through this pretty quickly. It goes back to the Stuart time. The scientific revolution was beginning to happen in the decades afterwards, well, during the Elizabethan period. And then the Industrial Revolution in the 1750s. So what do they say? This is a historian now talking. He's talking what he thinks the Bible taught people. The world has been created for man's sake. Oh. And other species were meant to be subordinate to his wishes and needs. Those theologians and intellectuals who felt the need to justify it could readily readily appear to classical philosophers. So there were two sources where you could make this point very clearly. The classical philosophers, the likes of Plato, Socrates, and particularly Aristotle. So Aristotle said, nature made nothing in vain. I said Aristotle, everything had its purpose. Now, plants were created for the sake of animals. Animals for the sake of man. Domestic animals were there to labor, wild ones to be hunted. So, this was the way people lived. Nature exists solely to serve man's interests. That's from a historian taught in Oxford about the relationship of humans to the natural world. So that's where all of us were, and that's what's deep within our cultural roots. And that's what we've now got to transform and give much more. So, I'm going to look very briefly. Two of the things he looks at is climate change. People were wondering, we know what's happened in the United States in the last few days. A man who thinks that climate change is a hoax has been elected. Now, he says climate change, a very solid scientific consensus, indicating we're presently witnessing a disturbing warming of the climate system. He goes on and gives the gases, why that is so. And then he goes on to say, who will suffer most? And he's very challenging to us. We have been using fossil fuel for the last umpteen generations. It's what has given us prosperity. But the implications for in the Philippines, with severe weather, the implications, for example, of sea level rise of a meter or two before the end of this century, these are horrendous. So this is one reason why we need to address this, as we're trying to, through the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, the conference of the parties this week in Marrakesh. So its worst impacts will be felt by developing countries. So here's something, we cause most of it, and yet poor people are suffering most. He's very strong on biodiversity. Remember when I showed you the compendium of the teaching of the church? There was a half paragraph on biodiversity. Not true here. He talks about the destruction of biodiversity, an economy that is a short-sighted approach to economy, commerce, and production. Here's a great scientist, he's still alive, Edward O. Wilson. He talks about the quenching of life exuberance, that's destruction of biodiversity, will it be more consequential to humanity than all present-day warming, ozone depletion, and pollution combined. Now, we may not be totally right on that, but the problem with extinction, it's forever. You are destroying the beauty and wonder of creation, and it is forever. He talks about, I'll just give you some brief data here from the International Union for Conservation of Nature. It estimates that 1 in 5 mammals will be gone. All the primates that we know will be gone from the wild in my lifetime. Hopefully if I live another 10 or 15 years. 1 in 4 plants are heading for extinction. 1 in 3 amphibians, they're very sensitive. And 1 in 8 birds. So this is extraordinary for this wonderful, beautiful planet that we're actually destroying it at such a rate. And we're not even conscious. That's the rate of extinction in the last century. We're not even conscious of it. We don't miss it unless we think deeply about it. They tell us that the structure of biodiversity ignores the fact, as far as all species now have intrinsic value independent of their usefulness to us. And that's very important. This is new teaching. It will have a huge impact upon us. Each species having intrinsic value challenges us to be attentive to them, their habitat, so that humans and all other creatures can thrive on this planet. So, this new kind of attentiveness to creation, not running away from creation, not running away, but being attentive, being knowledgeable, is going to have a new basis for our spirituality. From this perspective, protecting biodiversity should become one of the primary goals of human life. And if it's the primary goal of human life, it should be the vocation of every Christian. Traditionally, we talked about vocations as young men or young women going to religious life or the priesthood, they had a vocation. Now, as we see what's happening to our planet and what's happening to the poor, the vocation is very clear, it's for everyone. Is to be involved in this in whatever way they can. So the Catholic Church particularly should be involved in biodiversity because we claim to be the pro-life church. And if you're the pro-life church, we're not pro all of life. And there are probably about 10, we have no idea how many species live on the planet with us. We know about 2 million, we've described. Go to London, the Kew Gardens, you'll see that kind of figure there. But there could be 10 million. There could even be 30 million. And unfortunately, the vast majority live in the tropics, where a lot of damage has been done in the last number of years. So, one of the issues that he kind of is, and this is a big issue, that, and it comes across with politicians now, and it came across with the political reality in the United States. He assumes that we're going to have, you know, full employment. An approach to the integral ecology needs to take account of the value of labour. And that's just fine. And he gives a reason for it. God placed us in the garden to preserve it, be fruitful in it. That's fine, we agree with that. Craftsmen thus maintain the fabric of the world. So we're creating the world. And developing the creative world is a prudent way of caring for it. That's all very well. But the reality of what's happening in our planet is the rise of robots is making that very, very difficult. Almost every job involving sitting before a screen, manipulating information, is disappeared, will soon be achieved by a machine. Facebook, for example, at the moment, its data server is Kyber. It is a software program. One technician can take every 20,000 computers. So that's the way employment is going. Unfortunately, our politicians are not talking about it. They're talking about making more jobs. But how are they going to make more jobs in an automated world? The churches are not talking about it, in schools. So if you have 20-30% of the population unemployed, that's going to be very, very serious. So current situation, slow growth in wages, and that's actually what happened in the Rust Belt. A rising inequality, a growing flow of national income into profits or into patents. On machinery rather than into people's wages. So we've got to build up institutions that actually will be taking care of a society where not everyone is going to be involved in paid work. And then how are we going to actually make sure that people who cannot get paid work actually get enough to live on in a decent way, and you don't have again a very fractured society with a minority very seriously rich and a majority very seriously. Finally, the Pope doesn't shy away from the fact that we may not achieve this. That's the challenge in the next 20 or 30 years. Doomsday predictions can no longer be met with irony and disdain. We may well be leaving to coming generations debris, desolation, and filth. That's pretty strong language. It's hardly any of you or us would write it to my niece or nephew or grandniece, as you say, but he does that. And consumption, waste, environment has so stretched the planet's capacity that our contemporary lifestyle can only precipitate further catastrophe. And you had one here, have one here in Australia this year. 20% of your coral reef, the largest living organism on the planet, the coral polyps have died. So that is a catastrophe. By the way, it's also affected the people of East Africa, where you've had famines from Ethiopia right down to South Africa this year. And I was looking at a request this morning from agencies in Europe. They're talking about something up to 30 million people will be needing food aid by December of this year. So those are the fragilities of the planet that we're living in at the moment. So, accountability. So there's need for education. And I'm just going to go. So nothing will happen without education. Responsibilities for ourselves, for others, and for the others. That goes right back to Pope John Paul II. I suggest we have a synod, starting with each parish. The first year you would look at the issues of becoming intimate again with the natural world in your parish and in your diocese. You might begin to look at issues of, for example, how you would face energy, the use of fossil fuel, how you would look at waste, how you would look at extractive industry, how you might look at what's happening in the oceans beside you. And then prayers, rituals, ways of deepening our understanding of this. So year one, coming to know the local environment, local habitat ecosystems, people who may be not coming to church but who know these areas either professionally or people who have taken an interest in the bird life or the life of the habitat around, they would help us to do this sort of thing. Then we'd look at greenhouse gas emissions from agriculture or from industry. We'd look at maybe our diet of eating too much meat is having a huge impact. There'll be 10 billion people on the planet by 2080. How are we going to feed them all? So, then you'd use of energy, use of water, use of our waste. So to develop a spirituality which will make it easier for local Catholic groups to honour their relationship with God, fellow humans, other creatures, and the natural world itself. These appropriate liturgies to tease out what is new, a new, more harmonious relationship with all creation. Year two would be at a national level, and year three would be at an international level. This would be a huge boost to the ecological thinking and action around the world. The Catholic Church could play a vital role as a catalyst facilitating the whole process. So those are three, a potential for engaging this at the local, national and international level. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Father Sean. We now have some time for questions, and anyone can ask a question.
Given that, I seem to recall shortly after the encyclopedia, the encyclical came out, there was an article in the newspaper that said there was a group of cardinals, including our own Cardinal Pell, who rebelled against the Pope doing this. They basically told him to keep his nose out. The environment was none of his business. Do you have any thoughts on that?
My thoughts would be, well, just reading Laudato Si, he makes a very good case for what caring for our world as Christians. We believe that God creates our world, the whole process of life emerging and evolution. We believe in the incarnation, that the divine became part of the earth community. And we believe the Holy Spirit is the Lord and giver of life. So I think he has made all those arguments very clear. It's a challenge not for Catholics, it's a challenge for everyone in the world. It's a challenge for your grandchildren, great-grandchildren. We have an opportunity of about 20 years. If we take decisions now, we can live in a world where all of them will be able to meet their needs and enjoy the world. If not, for example, if you get a 4 degrees Celsius rise in temperature between now and year 2100, that would bring about a geological order of magnitude change. If you go back and look at geology, normally these times were 25 million years. The Lower Carboniferous, 25 million years. The Cretaceous, 65 million years. So these are serious issues. They're pressing, they're urgent. He has done a good analysis of it. I haven't read Cardinal Pell's analysis of it, but I know in climate change, for example, on climate change, you have the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. You know many scientists involved in that? 3,000. You know every country that signed up to COP, that's 195 countries, sign off on their reports. So I would say the science behind climate change is absolutely solid. And the same is true of the science behind the depletion of biodiversity. So science is telling us, the Pope is putting it in a religious context for us, of a new spirituality, and I go with that, and I forget about the other cardinals.
And remember that Father Sean spoke about the encyclical as not just being about climate change, that it's about the loss of biodiversity and the impact on the poor. So, yeah. Michael? Thank you.
About 30 years ago it was called global warming, and then they realised that global wasn't warming as much as they said, and it stopped. Then they said it was going to be climate change, and they said the oceans are rising. And the oceans aren't rising, they said that there was ice disappearing on various poles. That's not true, and there's so many things that are not true. And the main point is they always blame carbon dioxide. And carbon dioxide is an essential part of the planet. Well, all the trees that have been cut down actually need carbon dioxide. When they want to put up and make plants grow properly, they put them into a greenhouse, size of this property, full of carbon dioxide. And the amount of carbon dioxide is so small to start with, and the increase is so small, yet it's always the main thing that you hammer. Why do you hammer carbon dioxide? Because it tends to get half the population offside. If you just made the point about all the other pollution, people agree with that, that's obvious, but carbon dioxide is very dodgy.
Well, a very specific one, I'm not going to get into the, I've written a book on climate change. Between the end of the last ice age, which is 11,000 years ago, and the beginning of the industrial age, there were 280 parts per million of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. Now, that's very little. The vast majority are nitrogen and oxygen. So, if you had a million litres, most of them 800 plus, or just below 800,000 would be nitrogen, just below 200,000. But between the beginning of the industrial age, that's 1750, and now, at the moment, there are 406 parts per million. So we've gone up by a third. That is why warming is actually happening. The sea ice this year on the Arctic, it was the lowest sea ice that they have ever had in the Arctic, and there are huge issues with the Western Antarctic. Okay, if you go to Kiribati and you go to some of the islands in the Pacific, they will tell you that it is warming. And if you go and experience what was experienced in Fiji and in the Philippines, and these are issues of climate change in terms of weather. So, behind that you have, as I say, 3,000 scientists with very little interest in this, in the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. They came from the World Meteorological Association, they're very bright people, and they have no... But there are groups that have an interest. The fossil fuel industry, for decades in the United States, was saying this is no problem at all, carbon dioxide is good for plants. The reality is, in the whole area of agriculture, they will say you could have a 2% drop per decade if actually climate change gets much worse. So the fruitfulness of our soils, of our farms will be going down, and population levels grow. So I won't say any more. I mean, I would take you on with any kind of data, and if you want to do it with me overnight, I will. But I won't allow someone to say that carbon dioxide or the greenhouse gases the climate change is not happening. It is happening right across the world, and worse in some places than in others.
Well, mine's a very brief comment rather than a question, so I'm sorry to offend your sensibilities there. Just a comment to my friend over there. When you're looking at the data, it's very dangerous to look at data that's only spread across 2 or 3 years. If you look at the trend data that goes on for hundreds of years, then the trend data is up, whichever way you look at it. Just like a stock market, the stock market goes up and down. Generally, okay. Most stocks, they will go up.
Thank you.
This is going up.
Thank you. Is that a question up the back?
I think it's a real shift in our thinking. We're almost going back to the romantic era of Wordsworth and Coleridge, where we were seen as a continuum from the animals. Is that the way that you see it? We've lost our primacy. We're now part of that. Have we returned to that larger romantic vision?
Well, in his encyclical, I mean, he's, and rightly so, I mean, to get this new sensibility, poetry, music, all of those are very important, yeah. I mean, in no way is he changing our understanding of our place in the modern world, but he's telling us he uses the term about 4 or 5 times, tyrannical anthropocentrism. So we're like, so that's not part of the biblical tradition, and he emphasizes time and time again, so yeah. So we would need to have a lot more sensibility towards other creatures as part of the way we live, to enrich our own lives and to also make sure that it's there for the future. I mean, we talked about climate change has been a big issue over here. Biodiversity is actually worse. I mean, if you wipe out in this century 30% of the reality of the living organism of our planet, and particularly in the oceans where we've done enormous damage in the last 70 years, it will be a very, very poor world for my grand nieces and great grand nieces. So for our own sake, we need to care for the planet, but we need to care for them too. It's not just the human self-interest.
John, did you want to ask the question?
At Heathrow Airport, they're speaking of the fourth runway. One of the impacts of that is, when it's all in place, the share of carbon dioxide from air traffic in the UK will rise from 7% to 24%. We don't hear of the damage that tourism by traffic, air traffic, is doing.
We don't. Now, one of the things that is being discussed at Marrakesh, until now actually, in looking at greenhouse gas emissions country by country, we actually haven't included air fuel and bunker for shipping. Now we're beginning to try to do it. So again, that's a real issue. I mean, he talks there about our lifestyle. Can the lifestyle we've been living for the last 40, 50 years be continued into the future? And those are the kind of questions we have to ask and have to try and answer, and maybe some of it can't.
We can fit in probably three more questions if I go along these.
Phil has had his hand up for a long time.
Okay, Phil.
I'm just wondering, with regard to church leadership, how can we get our bishops and perhaps our local priests to speak more frequently on what the Pope has said?
Well, I did give a kind of a process that might be possible for parishes, for example. And I would say for a parish, any parish, if you have a social justice and ecology group, here's something that you might actually begin to do something with locally. Of a period like Advent, or particularly a period like Lent next year. So inform yourself a bit better about what you need to do, then begin to try and do something in that area that will cover the ecological issue, the justice issue itself, but also the spiritual resources we need. Maybe share what's happening with the parish leadership and with the diocesan leadership. But what we actually need is new action. We need action driven by this new understanding of our relationship with the natural world. And hopefully you can bring in the schools. Because people in high school or second level education, they're learning about all of this. They know it much better than we know it. But they may not be turning up to church every Sunday. But actually, if our liturgies were a lot more open in these areas, I would love to see a canon of the Mass, or three or four, written out of Laudato Si, that we would be actually thanking and praising God at Eucharist, because he's a lovely thing at the end of that beautiful encyclical. He talks about the Eucharist as being a cosmic event. And he says, if it's performed in St. Peter's or Rome or a Barrio chapel, it has the same reality. Here we are, as people of the planet, offering our universe up to the divine in gratitude. Now, we know much more about the universe than St. John or St. Paul did when he wrote the Cosmic Christ. We know a lot about it. We know we're also, our bodies are part of you. We're stardust. And we know we're connected with every other creature that St. Francis didn't know. He knew nothing about evolution. But we know all of these things. And we have absolute reason to give thanks. But locally, think locally, act locally.